Evaluation of postprandial triglycerides and cardiovascular events in patients with coronary artery disease. Dr. Laus, please.
Good morning, everybody. This study deals with the question of triglycerides. We have learned a lot about LDL cholesterol and HDL cholesterol. However, many of us are still uncertain how to interpret triglyceride levels in the serum. Indeed, the risk prediction by fasting serum triglycerides in patients at high cardiovascular risk is still a matter of debate. And there are data from primary prevention studies and also data from mechanistic basic science studies that maybe the triglyceride-rich lipoproteins that are increased after a meal may be especially atherogenic and risk modifiers in secondary prevention. Now, triglycerides are regulated not only by the time of and the type of a meal, but also by several other factors, and very important is the regulation of triglycerides by glucose and insulin. However, there is no prospective study that has looked at postprandial triglycerides and glucose tolerance in a cohort of patients in secondary prevention. So therefore, the aim of the Homburg cream and sugar study was to determine whether characterization of postprandial triglyceride kinetics may improve the prediction of cardiovascular events in addition to the assessment of glucose tolerance and traditional risk factors in patients with stable coronary artery disease. We have screened 3,125 patients coming to our clinic and 514 patients with clinically stable coronary artery disease documented by coronary angiography were enrolled in the study and underwent a sequential triglyceride and glucose tolerance test. Those patients with known diabetes received the FAT test only. And today we will report the 18-month follow-up data on our primary endpoint, which was the composite of cardiovascular death and cardiovascular hospitalization. The characteristics of these patients were typical for a cohort of coronary artery disease. When we look carefully, almost half of these patients have signs of diabetes and impaired glucose tolerance. Only 25% of this population had a completely normal glucose metabolism. 95% of this population was on statin treatment with a mean LDL cholesterol of 105. Importantly, glucose metabolism influences triglyceride kinetics, and as you can see, both the fasting triglycerides as well as the maximal postprandial triglycerides are increased in patients with impaired glucose tolerance or diabetes. And indeed, this is the multivariable Cox regression analysis. What we found is that when we look in the total cohort of patients, there was no risk prediction by fasting or postprandial triglycerides. And when we look in the group of patients with impaired glucose tolerance or diabetes, also we have no additional risk prediction despite higher fasting triglycerides when we look at fasting or the postprandial triglyceride increase. What was a little bit surprising is the result that in patients with normal glucose tolerance, the highest tertile, and those are patients with triglycerides above 150 milligrams per deciliter, this was associated with a threefold increase of risk, and also increased postprandial triglycerides were associated with a 4.4-fold increased risk, and this was standardized for traditional risk factors for lipids, for the HOMA index, for alcohol intake and medication. So we would conclude that combined testing of postprandial glucose and triglyceride tolerance is feasible in clinical practice. Postprandial triglycerides do not predict cardiovascular outcomes in the total cohort of patients with coronary artery disease on statin treatment. In subgroup analysis, we see that in patients with coronary artery disease and impaired glucose tolerance or diabetes, fasting and postprandial triglycerides are elevated but do not provide additional independent prediction of cardiovascular events. And in patients with coronary artery disease and normal glucose tolerance, both fasting and with superior risk prediction, postprandial triglycerides are independent markers for cardiovascular outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The paper is open for discussion, which means you may now ask your questions, please. Perhaps I may start. Should we now measure triglycerides in the non-fasting state? And could you comment a bit on your test meal?
I think for the majority of patients, the primary consequence of this analysis is that we have to look very carefully at glucose metabolism, also to interpret triglycerides. So, and this is in agreement with several other studies, that we do see that many more patients have an impaired glucose metabolism, and then they have an increased risk, and then the triglycerides do not provide an additional risk reduction. Interestingly, we may have to focus more on patients with normal glucose tolerance, which of course has to be tested first, and if those patients have high fasting triglycerides, they have an increased risk. And of course, it may be interesting in the future to look whether these patients may benefit from triglyceride-lowering intervention.
Further questions? So in conclusion, you would say it is most important to look at the glucose metabolism, and if the glucose metabolism is disturbed, if the patient is intolerant, then it doesn't make much sense to look at triglycerides. But if the glucose tolerance is normal, then you could have a term of triglyceride intolerance.
Yes. So in patients with diabetes, triglycerides are higher, but they do not provide additional prediction of risk. I think this is the point.
Yes. I think that